Welcome to the launch of the Adelphi book, Food Security in Asia, Challenges, Policies and Implications, by Dr. Monica Bothwell-Dutta. I'm Nicholas Redman, Editorial Director and Editor of the Adelphi series at the International Institute for Strategic Studies. With more than half the world's people and high levels of inequality, Asia lies at the center of the global food security challenge of the 21st century. The region, and especially China and India, is drawing on world stocks and importing more staples as its own farms strain to meet its growing middle class's desire for more meat and processed foods. Meanwhile, the smallholder farmers who supply 80% of the continent's food confront continued poverty as they struggle to raise output in the face of creeping environmental degradation, looming water shortages, and the unpredictable effects of climate change. In the book, Monica Bothwell-Dutta sets out the main challenges of food security in Asia and shows how current policies are falling short. The spike in global food prices in 2007-2008 not only led to riots on several continents, but also reawakened fears about the world's future ability to feed itself, as growing populations face greater demand on agricultural systems. Dr. Bothwell-Dutta is lecturer in international security at the University of New South Wales. She will speak today for approximately 20-25 minutes, after which you will have the opportunity to put your questions to her. If you would like to ask a question, the easiest way to do so is using the chat function on the webinar dashboard, and I will then put your question to Monica. You can send me your questions at any point. I'll now hand over to Monica, please.
Good evening or good morning, depending on where you're listening from. It's a pleasure to be giving this webinar on my Adelphi on Food Security in Asia, Challenges, Policies and Implications. As Nick pointed out, the Adelphi provides an analytical overview of the food security-related challenges facing developing countries in Asia, the policies being adopted in this context, and the implications for security. In my presentation, I will discuss these issues in broad brushstrokes, but I'd be happy to take questions on issues on which the presentation may not go into any sort of particular depth. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Thank you. To start off with, it's important to explain why Asia is important. Why is Asia's food security relevant and important to global food security and indeed wider security considerations? There are at least three reasons why Asia is at the heart of global food security concerns today. First of all, it is home to half the world's population, or rather over half the world's population, and around two-thirds of the global poor and hungry. Second, it's also home to China and India, two of the world's most populous countries and two of the world's largest food producers and consumers. Both these countries have been turning increasingly to the international food market for meeting the demand for key food crops, while facing growing constraints on their respective agricultural resource base, including arable land and freshwater resources. Thirdly, the region is made up mainly of developing low-income or lower-middle-income countries that are struggling to cope with a complex mix of factors that are driving food insecurity in the region and that threaten the well-being of hundreds of millions of people in the region. For these reasons alone, Asia's food security is critical to food security at the global level. Next slide, please. What do we mean by food security? It's important to lay this out right at the beginning. Now, the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization, or the FAO, provided the currently prevailing definition of food security in 2001, and the definition states that food security exists, quote, when all people at all times have physical, social, and economic access to sufficient, safe, and nutritious food that meets their dietary needs and preferences for an active and healthy life. Now, unlike earlier versions, this definition underlines the significance of physical, social, and economic access to food for those who are the most poor and malnourished. It holds that food security is not just about food quantity, that is, having enough to eat, but also about food quality, that is, having access to safe, nutritious food according to one's dietary requirements and cultural tastes. So it integrates the problems of malnourishment and food safety into the broader equation. Although this definition is a vast improvement on earlier conceptualizations of food security that focused mainly on food supply and demand, it still falls short of considering the role played by power relations within food systems. That is, where social, political, and economic control lies within food systems, including who controls food-producing resources and decision-making behind how these resources should be used. In a region like Asia, where small farmers produce the vast majority of the food, but make up the majority of those who are also poor and hungry, without adequate access to food-producing resources and little or no say in policy-making processes, it really becomes important then to examine food security more broadly than within the confines of the food security definition provided by the FAO. Next slide, please. Now, how has Asia managed to feed its citizens up until now? A number of developments ensured that agricultural production kept pace with population growth in the region over the past few decades, since the mid-20th century. And agricultural productivity kept increasing at a brisk pace. Across the region, the Green Revolution, under the Green Revolution, and the implementation of industrial farming technologies backed by public investment in agriculture and supportive policies, there were serious improvements in crop yields, and this actually helped to lift millions out of poverty and provide them with food security. So, for example, cereal production in Asia doubled between 1970 and 1995, and actually kept ahead of population growth. There were serious gains made in reducing poverty in the region, led by China, where between 1990 and 2009, the proportion of people living on less than $2 a day actually plunged from over 84%, so roughly 968 million people, to just over 27%, so around 360 million. At the same time, countries like China and India also began to resort increasingly to import certain food crops to meet demand at home, and in doing so, outsourcing the production of these crops. For example, China now is the largest importer of soybeans in the world, importing an impressive 58 million tons in 2012. And India has also seen imports of pulses and edible oils soar. So if Asia's managed to feed its citizens up until now, why should we be worried looking into the future? Next slide, please. So after being largely successful in feeding their growing, increasingly demanding populations in the last half century by raising crop production through agricultural expansion, higher yields, farmer-friendly policies, and subsidized food programs for their poorest citizens, developing countries in the region now face a multiple number of challenges to food security that require a break from the business-as-usual approach. The Green Revolution that swept across the region from 1960s onwards allowed many countries in the region to become self-sufficient in staples. But in many of these countries now, food systems are reaching a tipping point. The challenges are greater than during the Green Revolution. The world now needs to feed more people with rapidly diversifying diets using less and more degraded natural resources like farmland and freshwater. So, for example, across Asia, a growing number of people are now consuming a greater share of their overall caloric intake from vegetables, fruits, fish, meat, and dairy products. And the direct consumption of cereals, including rice, has been declining in almost all countries in the region. This shift is important because in consuming meat and dairy products in greater amounts, Asians are now consuming more grain and more water than ever before, as animal products require greater amounts of land and water to grow. And ultimately, this means that changing consumption patterns require more land and freshwater resources to be brought under food production. At a time when urbanization and industrialization are putting growing pressure on agricultural resources, and decades of industrial agricultural practices have actually led to high levels of environmental degradation and pollution, including soil degradation and pollution of critical freshwater resources and fisheries. At the same time, the region is set to be hit hard by climate change with adverse food consequences for food production, particularly in seasonally dry and tropical regions where even moderate temperature increases of 1 to 2 degrees are expected to lead to declines in yields of major crops like rice, wheat, and maize. And in fact, yields of these crops are already showing signs of decline or stagnation in parts of East, South, and Southeast Asia. Although Asian countries are behind major producers like the US, Brazil, and EU when it comes to biofuels, they are nonetheless increasingly viewing biofuels as a viable and green alternative to non-renewable sources of energy. China already has an emerging biofuel industry, and Indonesia has been using growing amounts of palm oil to produce biodiesel. The production of first-generation biofuels involves diverting food crops for biofuel feedstock, which means diverting food for human consumption towards the production of fuel. And we now know that the food price crisis of 2007-2008 was actually one of the reasons behind it was biofuels. They played a key role in pushing up food prices of crops like maize and wheat as they were being diverted to produce biofuels in larger than ever before quantities. And of course, small farming households in Asia are amongst the hardest hit when food prices increase. Small farming households tend to be net consumers of food, meaning they resort to the market to fulfill their food security needs. And when prices of food rise suddenly and sharply, they are unable to respond quickly by boosting production due to a number of disadvantages they face. And they end up struggling to provide themselves with adequate nourishment. Often they sell assets to be able to afford food, banishing themselves to worse economic circumstances in the long run and entrenching themselves deeper into poverty. Next slide, please. So what are the implications of these challenges for stability and security in the region? As more and more agricultural land is brought under urban and industrial use or under large-scale plantation-style agriculture, small farming communities across the region are finding themselves being pushed off their farmland with very little or no compensation. In countries like China, India, Vietnam, the Philippines, and Cambodia, land rights remain weakly enforced, and small farmers remain without land titles in large numbers. So they're unable to defend their interests when government and big business join hands to acquire land for development. In China, for example, around 4 million rural families per year have their land confiscated by local government officials to be sold to developers, despite the presence of laws preventing farmland conversion and government promises of land use rights to farming households. This, together with other obstacles faced by rural communities in China, has been fueling rural discontent, and there have been a growing number of protests in rural areas, including against forced land acquisitions. Similar protests have been witnessed in other countries like India, Vietnam, Indonesia, and Cambodia. And these protests often turn violent as local communities clash with government and private security forces. There are also concerns around forced land acquisitions for Chinese investments in agriculture in other Asian countries and also in South America and countries like Brazil and Argentina. Small farmers across Asia are finding agriculture an increasingly unviable source of livelihood and continue to migrate to urban areas in large numbers to search for a better living, which is not exactly a desirable development given that the demand for food and the demand for different kinds of food is also growing while the resources available to produce this food are diminishing. At the international level, the deteriorating state of fisheries across Asia and water shortages have served to heighten the risk of conflict in the region over disputed territories. China is a major actor here, and it shares transboundary water bodies with a number of countries in the region. The country's distant water fishing fleet has been rapidly expanding, as has Beijing's assertiveness over disputed seas and the resources they contain, including fish, oil, gas, leading to an increase in maritime tensions in the region. Incidents involving fishing vessels have actually exacerbated existing territorial disputes, including in the South China Sea between Beijing on the one hand and Manila, Hanoi, and others on the other hand. China and India's border dispute over Arunachal Pradesh has increasingly become tied up with water security concerns, as New Delhi sees Beijing as having a chokehold of sorts over major rivers that emerge from the Tibetan Plateau, including the Brahmaputra, which is known as the Yalong Tsangpo in China. As water scarcity in the region grows, the strategic importance of these waterways is likely to increase even further. Finally, climate change and extreme weather events pose a serious threat to human security of hundreds of millions of people in Asia. Changes in rainfall patterns are already affecting rain-fed agriculture in Asia, and the frequency and intensity of floods and droughts is set to rise. In 2010, the Asian Development Bank reported that over 30 million people were at least temporarily displaced by environmental and weather-related disasters in the region. As climate change results in more frequent and intense adverse weather events, tens of millions more are likely to be similarly displaced. Asia is actually home to 7 of the 10 countries in the world with populations most likely to be at risk from rising sea levels in 2050, and these include India, China, Bangladesh, Indonesia, Japan, the Philippines, and Vietnam. Next slide, please. Despite the complexities of challenges facing food and agricultural systems in the region, food and agricultural policies in Asia remain fragmented, and they often clash with the very goals that they're geared towards achieving. One identified means of achieving food security and reducing poverty has been economic growth through foreign direct investment in agricultural production and agricultural resources. Unfortunately, foreign and domestic private investment in agriculture in many developing countries in the region has not been put through the kind of checks required to ensure environmental sustainability and the human security of local communities, including livelihood security. In Cambodia, for example, the government can, by law, lease out agricultural land up to 10,000 acres large to private companies as economic land concessions. Now, these ELCs are meant to comply with environmental and social impact assessment so as not to violate land ownership and land use rights of peasants, and need to be undertaken by public consultation. But the reality is quite different, as the decision-making process behind granting these ELCs remains opaque. And in June 2007, the UN Special Representative of the Secretary General for Human Rights in Cambodia actually pointed out that in the allocation of these ELCs, the government has failed to uphold the rights of affected communities. In countries like Indonesia, energy policies that emphasize the use of biofuels to reduce dependency on imports of renewable energy sources are having an impact on agricultural resources available for food production and the livelihoods of local communities. The rapid expansion of oil palm plantations in Indonesia has resulted in a significant loss of forest cover and also redirected land away from use for food production, including rice farming. In Vietnam and in Cambodia, there has been an overwhelming focus on rice self-sufficiency in the name of food security. But in fact, it is a very narrow view of food security because it does not adequately consider access to food and malnutrition, which are serious challenges in both countries. Vietnam is now the world's second largest exporter of rice, but a sizable rice surplus has not helped eradicate hunger and poverty from the country. And roughly 11% of the population remains malnourished, while about 43% of Vietnamese live on less than $2 a day. The government actually aims to keep about 38 million hectares of land locked into rice production. And this is despite small rice farmers actually having little scope to boost income only through rice farming and have actually been relying on other ways to supplement their wages. Finally, poor governance remains a problem for the majority of developing countries in the region. And this affects the most basic factors at the heart of food security in Asia. In India and the Philippines, for example, food safety net programs continue to suffer from problems of corruption, mismanagement, wastage, and inefficiency. These problems also affect policymaking and implementation more broadly and continue to contribute to food insecurity despite adequate food supplies being available at the national level. Next slide, please. So this brings us to the question, what can policymakers do to address these complex challenges that are facing, that Asian countries are facing when it comes to food security? Amongst other things, policymakers need to place the interests of small farmers at the heart of agricultural policymaking, given that they produce around 80% of the region's food. Efforts need to be focused on boosting agricultural productivity through greater investment in agricultural infrastructure, services, and research and development. And this needs to go hand in hand with efforts towards rural development that include education, healthcare, and sanitation for rural communities. The governments need to protect the interests of local communities and the sustainability of food systems when it comes to investments from private actors, especially when it comes to large-scale investments in agricultural resources. And here, protecting the land rights of local communities, small farmers, and ensuring access to productive resources becomes key. At the same time, focus needs to be paid on fisheries, given that fish remain the major source of protein for people living in Asia. Governments need to ensure adherence to international norms on the sustainable use and management of fisheries. When it comes to sharing cross-border water resources, overarching and permanent frameworks for cooperation need to be fleshed out and committed to. And when it comes to climate change, there has to be a bottom-up approach that considers the needs of frontline communities that are actually facing devastation at the hands of the impacts of climate change and extreme weather events. Environmental sustainability is also a key goal for governments when it comes to food security. And here the IISTD report in 2008 is actually quite a good guide for governments, because it talks about the ways in which local communities can be involved in ensuring environmental sustainability. So for example, it calls for governments to stop subsidies on pesticides and fertilizers and actually replace them with incentives to use ecologically sound agricultural practices, such as integrated pest management that combines the use of pest-resistant crops with different planting or harvesting times and so on. Farmers and local communities can also be paid for ecosystem services, which means essentially paying them for, amongst other things, keeping land farmed, looking after the land around it, keeping waterways clean, treating farm animals well, and maintaining the social structure of rural areas. Other suggested ways in the report include a strengthening of local markets and the creation of alternative consumer markets for certified organic and sustainably produced food. Climate change adaptation measures, as I mentioned before, need to focus on frontline communities, and they need to focus on not just hard adaptive measures, which includes infrastructure such as sea dikes and reinforced or more durable buildings, but also soft adaptive measures like community mobilization plans and social safety nets, livelihood diversification, and increased institutional capacity. These are just some of the ways in which food security challenges in the region can be addressed in an adequate and holistic manner. Some governments in the region are moving in the direction of adopting a more holistic approach towards dealing with food security challenges, but there is still a long way to go before we can actually see what we need to see when it comes to tackling the complex challenges facing the region and the people who live there. Thank you.
Monica, thank you very much. Time now for questions. You can use the chat function or you can raise a hand. I'll try to unmute your microphone. The easiest way is the chat function. Let me ask the first one while you type away. Monica, you mentioned in the presentation that there are many facets to food security, and it's not simply a question of supply and demand. How aware, in your opinion, are regional governments of the broader links?
Thanks very much, Nick. As I mentioned at the end of the presentation, governments in the region are slowly waking up to the sheer complexity of challenges that are coming together in the name of or in the context of food security in their domestic context and also at the regional level. In the aftermath of the 2007-2008 food price crisis in particular, governments across the region realized that first of all, reliance on food imports is not something that is sufficient in ensuring food security at home. Furthermore, I think it also then led to the realization that in some countries that national level adequacy in terms of having enough food stocks does not necessarily translate into food security at the domestic level. Now, countries like India, for example, have adopted policies whereby there is now a focus not just on food production in terms of boosting productivity and increasing food production to meet growing demand, but also to look at the needs of small farmers, because small farmers ultimately are those who constitute the majority of those who are food insecure, ironically, in Asia. And so there are now policies that have been put in place that look at what small farmers need in terms of extension, credit services, access to markets, training, information, and so on. At the same time, in countries like Vietnam and the Philippines, even in Indonesia, rice remains somewhat of a national obsession when it comes to food security. Self-sufficiency in rice continues to be the guiding goal of food security policies, despite the fact that barring the Philippines, most countries in Asia, people in most countries in Asia have actually been eating less and less rice in terms of the share of rice in overall food consumption. So it's a bit of a mix in terms of how governments in the region continue to look at food security.
Monica, thank you. A follow-up question is, you did mention small farmers in that answer. Why are small farmers so important?
Well, Nick, as I mentioned, small farmers produce around 80% of the food in the region. That alone makes them the most sort of important cog in the wheel when it comes to food security and maintaining food production productivity across the region. Unfortunately, small farmers fundamentally lack the kind of resources and rights that they need to ensure that they can continue to meet the challenges that come their way when it comes to increasing food production, ensuring environmental sustainability. If we take land rights and access to land, for example, now it's well known now that small farmers tend to invest in using agricultural resources in a sustainable manner only when they know that they will be able to reap the benefits of this investment in the long term. But if they don't have the security of tenure, if they're not sure that they will still be able to have access to the land that they're working on in the near future or in the long term even, then they are less likely to invest in sustainable agricultural practices that actually ensure that resources like agricultural land, fresh water, forest lands are actually used in a manner whereby they will still be available for use for future generations. This is just one small problem that they face. The other is that when food prices rise suddenly and sharply, small farmers don't have access to timely information and the resources required to increase food production to respond to these higher food prices. So actually they end up being disadvantaged in most cases, because while on the one hand they cannot respond quickly to these rising prices, on the other they end up not being able to afford these higher prices, and so facing higher levels of food insecurity. So small farmers are not just important because they are producing the majority, the bulk of the food in the region, but small farmers are important, or small farming households and communities are important, because they're also at the receiving end. They're also those who are the most food insecure in the region, and that is why policymakers need to put small farmers and their needs and interests at the heart of policymaking when it comes to food security in Asia.
Okay, Monica, thank you very much. Question from Samantha Jarvis. Has China been unfairly accused of land grabbing? I guess this question is around the idea of plantations being established in other countries to feed some of the larger markets, which obviously an issue that's been in the news over the last few years.
Land grabbing is certainly a very emotive word. It evokes certain notions around what is happening with respect to the rights of local communities who actually live and work on this land. China has certainly been investing, seriously investing, in agricultural production in countries, not just in Asia, but also in Brazil and Argentina, where it's been investing in infrastructure to produce things like, soybean production and other food crops for use to be shipped back home. It's also been investing in agricultural land. Now, these land deals are, to a large extent, shrouded in ambiguity. We don't know exactly what is going on. That is the way the Chinese government operates. To a large extent, I think governments need to ensure that the kind of investments that are taking place in agricultural resources and in agricultural sectors within their borders are fair to those communities who have traditionally tilled the land and those who rely upon farming for their livelihoods and for food security. At the end of the day, it has to be, the responsibility, I think, mainly lies with the government of the day, but then also I think major actors like China and India increasingly also need to be perhaps pushed to commit to certain ethical means, ethical ways of investing in agriculture overseas, because clearly they increasingly see the need to do so. And one way of going forward is perhaps asking them to go by the voluntary guidelines on the responsible governance of tenure of land, fisheries and forests in the context of food security, which has been endorsed by the Food and Agriculture Organization Committee on World Food Security in 2012. But you know, these guidelines remain voluntary, and really there's no way of enforcing them.
Okay, thank you, Monica. I have a question from Anna Ashton. In terms of environmental sustainability efforts, are they difficult to roll out due to more local mistrust of new methods, or the financial cost and time-consuming complex nature of implementing a totally new system?
Well, in the book I actually talk about agroecological farming practices that look towards local communities and traditional knowledge that they hold of the resources that they have been using for generations and the resources of which they have been traditional custodians. Now, agroecological practices actually are one way of overcoming this challenge of how to maintain environmental sustainability. It involves all stakeholders actually communicating in clear terms to one another, because as the person who's posed the question mentioned, there may be a degree of mistrust between local communities and government agencies who try and implement new methods, or indeed private actors, NGOs that come in with new ways and new thinking. So there has to be some sort of a dialogue between all stakeholders, and it has to be clear and transparent so that all stakeholders are actually fully involved and upfront about what is at stake for them and how all concerns may be addressed in a manner that ultimately leads to beneficial outcomes when it comes to environmental sustainability.
Monica, thank you. Another question from Alia Mubayed. To what extent is food security also impacted by energy security in Asia? And how should we think about the interaction between these two security dimensions?
That's a really good question. Energy security, there is a very strong nexus between energy security and food security. When it comes to biofuels, for example, as I mentioned earlier, biofuels played a crucial role, it is now believed by many experts, in pushing up food prices during the 2007-2008 crisis. And we know that at the moment we're working with first generation biofuels, and these require food crops for their production, bioethanol and biodiesel. Biodiesel is produced in Asia. Crude palm oil is being used to produce biodiesel, and Indonesia is at the forefront when it comes to the countries who are investing in biofuel production in contemporary times. Now, if taking the case of Indonesia, oil palm plantations have been expanding at an astonishing rate. And while to an extent this is being done in the name of energy security, it's being done in the name of economic growth, but also in the name of energy security, because crude palm oil is seen as one way to reduce dependency on imports of renewable fuels and one way of going green when it comes to energy consumption. At the same time, what's happening is indigenous communities are being pushed off land that they rely on for their food security. Now, land rights in Indonesia also remain weakly enforced, as in other countries in the region. So it becomes quite difficult for local communities to actually fight for adequate compensation for the land that they've worked on and lived on for years and relied on for their food security. So certainly in that sense, the impact on income security and then on food security is quite stark. When it comes to the link between biofuel production or the growing quest for biofuels in the region on the one hand and food security on the other.
Okay, Monica, thank you. A follow-up on that, is there any sense within the region that there is a problem because it's companies rather than governments that are the primary actors in food and energy markets? From the point of view of trying to then secure energy and food security.
Mm-hmm. That's a good question as well. It would be probably hard to say to what extent there is mistrust against private companies and investments. What is clear is that certainly small farming communities are losing out with respect to, or in many cases, they are losing out when it comes to investments by large agribusinesses, because it leads to land consolidation in the hands of these large agribusinesses. And that, of course, then impacts access to land for these small farming communities. At the end of the day, private investors are driven by profit incentive rather than any sort of larger goal of, you know, environmental sustainability or improving the welfare of local communities. So in that respect, certainly local communities, by experience, remain wary of private investors. There's also, you know, this is not to say that local communities are always unified in terms of the response to offers by private investors or government efforts to make deals on behalf of private investors in certain countries. There's often conflict within communities, and that's another source of conflict where stakeholders within local communities actually have you know, disagreements over what to do with land that is communally owned.
Thank you, Monica. Another question from my own part. Which are the most food security stressed countries in Asia right now? Which are the ones that most concern you when you look at food security in broad terms?
Well, I think certainly China and India need, you know, deserve special mention here. Both countries are looking at rapidly shrinking agricultural land, while you know, industrialization and urbanization carry on at very brisk pace. And of course, for urban development and industrial projects, the land that is being brought under development is agricultural land. Now, this is obviously not an ideal scenario because food, the demand for food and the diversification of the kind of food that these countries or you know, growingly affluent people in these countries are demanding requires greater amounts of agricultural land, freshwater resources to be produced. So this tussle between agricultural production on the one hand and urbanization and industrialization on the other is really you know, reaching fever pitch in both China and India. When it comes to water availability, water scarcity is a serious challenge for both these countries. In India, about one third of the population already lives in water-stressed areas. You know, China is resorting to colossal projects like the South North Water Diversion Project to divert water from the water-rich south to the parched north. So these factors really make China and India two very, very prominent cases when it comes to how these different factors are coming together to make food security a really serious problem for both of them.
Okay, a question from Camila Pichara. What about other regions, Latin America, for example? It's somewhat beyond your remit, Monica, but are there any broad lessons from the study that you can pass across?
Sure. Small farmers across the world share their concerns when it comes to access to land rights and access to land and tenure security. In fact, the food sovereignty movement that is led by La Via Campesina or the International Peasants Movement very effectively highlights how the extent to which these concerns are shared across borders and you know, by small farmers around the world. So when we talk about food security in Asia and the challenges that countries in the region are facing, really these challenges are not isolated or particular to Asia as such. They are shared by developing countries around the world, also in South America and in Africa.
Monica, thank you. Question from Mark Boda. India has passed a number of food security laws, but now Modi is elected. Might things change?
I dare not speculate on that one. I think that's one to wait and watch. As with, you know, so many things that we are now wondering about with respect to the Modi government and how it's going to proceed forward. I think this is probably going to be one to wait and watch.
Mm-hmm. Casting your crystal ball aside for a moment, Monica, what would you regard as the major choices or questions facing the government in terms of the food security agenda?
Oh, I think the food, the whole... The food security bill itself, probably, you know, it may be something the government decides to revisit, given the amount of debate there was around whether, you know, India, given its given the extent of the deficit, the fiscal deficit, how, you know, how sensible is it for India to actually commit, for the government to commit to providing you know, the right to food to people and the amount of food that it has committed to procuring and providing using the public distribution system that it has under the bill. So it may well be something that the government decides to revisit. But certainly, I think, given the emphasis that Modi certainly in recent days has placed on poor people and, you know, farmers being one of the poor constituencies in India, you know, it may well be that the government turns its attention or gives greater attention to the plight of small farmers across the country. So yeah, certainly it remains to be seen to what extent food security will remain on the agenda, on the government's agenda under the new government. But I have a feeling that, you know, and I could be wrong, I have a feeling that if Modi is serious about his commitment to, you know, reducing poverty in the country, then one of the ways, or one of the critical ways that this is going to be addressed is by looking at the agricultural sector and looking at, you know, the rural communities in India.
Okay, great. Thank you, Monica. Another question from Alia Mubayad. With respect to vulnerability to food price volatility, which countries do you consider to be in the worst position? Which are the most vulnerable?
That's a tough one. Food price volatility, you know, to a large extent, given the interconnected nature of food markets these days and the extent to which agricultural sectors have been liberalized, There tends to be, you know, a transmission of higher food prices across the border into the domestic realm. But again, governments often take measures to limit the extent to which rising food prices at the international level have an impact at the domestic level. So it's hard to say, really, you know, specifically at any given point in time, or more generally speaking, which countries are more vulnerable to rising food prices. But in this day and age, as the food price crisis in 2007-2008 showed us, and again when food prices peaked in early 2011, really in the current global food economy, where we have such an interconnectedness of markets and also food supply chains, it's, you know, I don't think any country is completely exempt from being affected.
Okay, a question from Richard Saunders. What's the role of GM in securing Asia's food security?
And of course, I knew somebody would ask that controversial question. In the Adelphi, I advocate the approach that is suggested by the IISS report of 2008, where I say I agree with a problem-oriented approach to biotechnology, given that, you know, food security or the those who are food secure in the region are also made up mainly of small farming communities or small farmers in the region. Any technology that takes control away from the local level needs to be considered with respect to the impact that it may have on the ability of local farmers to make, to undertake research or to undertake further agricultural research independently and to own expertise collectively and own plant genetic resources such as seeds and trees and nurseries collectively. So I would advocate the approach that the utility of biotechnologies is best assessed in the context of how they impact on the abilities of local communities to collectively own expertise and their capacity to undertake further research independently. When it comes to Asia and the socioeconomic context that exists there, it would seem that participatory breeding projects and agroecological approaches are perhaps best suited to the region.
Monica, part of the attention around food security in Asia is the projections for population growth in the world generally, but then focused on Asia. Within Asia, what are the countries that are facing the greatest challenge with regard to expected population growth?
Well, overall, population growth rates have been declining. In Asia, although the number of people obviously continues to grow at a relatively rapid pace. The Philippines is the first country that comes to mind with respect to the obstacles that are faced by the government when it comes to being able to pass or implement any sort of serious policies when it comes to, say, family planning. When I talk about the Philippines, I'm particularly aware of how agricultural productivity in the country has been declining at the same time when population growth continues unabated. So certainly in any of the countries in the region where there are significant or worrying trends when it comes to the productivity of key staple food crops, while population growth really continues at a steady pace, then we have reasons, perhaps some reason to be concerned with respect to how limited agricultural resources are going to be able to meet the growing demand for food, especially in the context of growing populations.
Okay, Monica, thank you. I'm just seeing if we have more questions. We don't have any right now, so let me ask another, which concerns. It's a follow-up to GM. Is there much popular resistance in some countries to GM crops?
Again, this is a mixed bag. There are different. There's mixed response to GM in countries across Asia, whether it's India or countries in Southeast Asia like Vietnam or Cambodia or the Philippines. I think at the heart of that concerns around GM, some of the issues that lie there are issues around environmental sustainability, the impact of GM crops on biodiversity, for example. Small farmers often rely on traditional methods. Their farms are quite biodynamic, where they are engaged in not sort of monocropping, but they grow multiple crops on one farm, and so the actual agricultural output per unit area is actually quite high compared to large farms, and they're more efficient in terms of total factor productivity. GM crops are grown in plantation style and require large tracts of land. And then, of course, there's a whole host of concerns around implication for biodiversity when it comes to GM crops, and that's one of the issues that detractors, of course, raise in these countries. But then, of course, the control over seeds is another major issue that small farmers, raise or those concerned on their behalf raise. Small farmers often have to buy into these packages, whereby they not only buy the seeds to grow the crop, but then also buy the Roundup or the herbicides that have been developed specifically to kill everything else on the farm other than the crop, the GM crop being grown. And that, of course, then ties into not just biodiversity, but also how farmers then become tied into buying these very expensive packages year on year. And this is not something that is necessarily they can afford to do, and especially if you know they have a single crop failure, then of course that then entraps them into this spiral of debt, and often leads to very dire circumstances.
Thank you, Monica. Last one from me. When we look at the problems of balancing food security, as against energy security and development and also urbanization, within the region, either at the governmental level or at the subnational level, if we went down to a region, is there any example you think is particularly good example of actually balancing those very complex demands?
It's probably a little sad that I can't think of a single stellar example of that, just because the nature of policies in the region just continues to be very fragmented. Governments continue to function in a way where agencies don't necessarily speak to one another. So government agencies that are involved in development or rural development, for example, or agricultural production or enhancing agricultural productivity don't necessarily speak to those who are focused on finding alternative means of, renewable sources of energy. There's not much dialogue between these different departments or agencies, and so there's a very siloed approach. And this is something that really needs to change. If there's one thing that needs to change right away, this is probably the headline grabber, that often within governments, even within international agencies, there are units working at cross purposes, even though the broader goal might be to ensure might be same with respect to ensuring food security, environmental sustainability, but in terms of the initiatives that are being undertaken, they're often sort of clashing with one another, and therefore actually not doing much to actually resolve the problem or to meet the challenges that lie ahead.
Okay, Monica, thank you very much. We have a question from Meiko Hama. The most food insecure often are those who are politically marginalized for ethnic reasons or tribal reasons or from being from political oppositions. There is rarely enough incentive for central governments to improve food security for them. They are often not on the priority for providing good roads or access to markets. Sometimes sensational land grab headlines are used as political propaganda to bring down the government or get rid of certain foreign investors. Do you have any thoughts on this dimension? Also, are we in need of a revolution in lifestyles we seek and the types of food we eat? Some suggest insect eating as the solution to our food problems.
That's a good question. Certainly, marginalized communities suffer disproportionately when it comes to not having adequate access to productive resources, land titles, and this is obviously a problem that requires political will to be addressed adequately. In countries across the region, whether it's Indonesia, Vietnam, India for that matter, tribal communities that have lived on land or collectively owned forest lands for generations are now facing the challenge of fighting for that land because their rights have not been protected, or even though there are laws in place, they're not enforced properly. So they are actually fighting for their land rights and for their continued use of these critical resources. So certainly there has to be some movement politically when it comes to protecting their rights. And of course, it remains to be seen to what extent governments will be willing to show that to take those measures required. When it comes to changing lifestyles, I think it's probably something that has been widely advocated for a while now. The UN has come out and said, we need to eat more, we need to eat less meat if we want to ensure the sustainability of our planet and our finite resources like agricultural land and freshwater resources. At the same time, you have people in regions like Asia who are only just becoming affluent enough to be able to afford alternative sources of protein, so you know, being able to afford fish or meat and meat products. So it becomes politically, it becomes a hot potato. You know, governments are unlikely to turn around and tell these people to stop eating food that they have aspired to eat and now are able to afford. When it comes to radical thinking like eating insects, well, it's not so radical, is it? Because we know in certain parts of the world already people eat these sources of protein and are actually local delicacies. So perhaps it's a matter of spreading that knowledge far and wide and getting more people to buy into this idea that, you know, there are other sources of protein that may not be conventionally preferred, but, you know, maybe it's something that we all need to try.
I think that's a very good note to wrap up on, Monica. Thank you. For those who don't have a copy of the book, you can buy it in soft cover via the IISS website, or you can get it via Kindle. I hope you do read it. It's a very good book, and I wanted to thank very much Monica for giving this presentation today. Also, by the way, for being such a wonderful author. It's been a pleasure to work with you. I want to thank everybody for joining us. Next month, we will have a webinar on the latest Adelphi to come out, which is Aaron Friedberg's monograph on Beyond Air Sea Battle. But I just wanted to thank you once again for joining us, and I hope you'll be with us again soon. Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you.